Minister for Finance and Corporate Affairs, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, dignitaries and friends, we are gathered here today to celebrate the birth centenary of Sri Nani Palkhivala, a man of letters, a preeminent jurist, a tax expert, a devotee of the Constitution, a speaker par excellence, and among the noblest sons of India. When he spoke, thousands came to hear his oratory and wisdom. I have pleasure now to invite Mr. R. Anand, Trustee Palkhivala Foundation, to give his welcome address.
Chief guest of today's centenary celebration, Mr. Honorable Minister of Finance and Corporate Affairs, Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman, my colleague trustees on the dais, Mr. Mahalingam, Mr. Ranganathan, Mr. Balaji, other trustees of the foundation, members of the governing council, representatives of the media, distinguished invitees, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Palkhivala Foundation, I extend a warm welcome to all of you present here on the momentous occasion of the Nani Palkhivala centenary celebrations. Nani Palkhivala was an individual par excellence and aptly referred to as God's gift to India. For him, the country and the issues facing the country were more important than individuals. Most of the chartered accountants and lawyers in the formative years, notably 1970s, 80s and early 1990s, benefited immensely from his post-budget analysis delivered without a slip of paper in his hand. Had he been alive, he will be exactly 100 years and 3 days old today. He would have been the first person to be present in this hall to engage himself enthusiastically in a conversation with the Honorable Chief Guest. Palkhivala Foundation, which was formed just after his demise, is 17 years and 12 days old today. When we started the foundation way back in 2003, it was our desire to perpetuate the memory of the legendary lawyer and also educate the citizens of Chennai about the views and ideals of late Sri Nani Palkhivala. We accomplished this by conducting a series of public lectures covering various subjects. About 8 months back, the trustees in a meeting decided that we need to have a proper centenary celebration event to mark the milestone and to remember one of the most noble souls this country has ever produced. We decided on two distinct approaches. First and foremost, it was felt appropriate to bring out a book containing most of the Palkhivala memorial speeches conducted by the foundation between 2003 and 2019. This publication is now complete and will be released today by the Honorable Minister. It was a Herculean task undertaken by the supervisory efforts of Mr. K. Balaji, trustee, who executed this vital mission well within the due date. The second decision, and a very important decision that we took, was to develop a theme for the next couple of years for the foundation. After some discussions, it was unanimously decided that the theme would be to improve the spirit of corporate governance in this country. Ladies and gentlemen, you will all agree that if we need to attain the targeted goal of $5 trillion economy, corporate India and business community as a whole should come together to improve the overall quality and content of corporate governance. It is quite disconcerting that the past few months have thrown up several skeletons and corporate lapses which have left the regulators and public at large in a state of discomfort. While there is a feeling that regulators have to up the ante in ensuring that lapses are contained, there is also a viewpoint that excessive regulations stifle growth and innovation. The answer probably lies in striking the right balance between over-regulation and under-regulation. Having said that, it is up to us collectively, namely owners, shareholders, directors, auditors, and other stakeholders, to ensure that governance standards stand both the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. The best that we can leave behind for the next generation is to hand over a platform of good ethical practices and good governance. Some may remark that these lapses can at best be called aberrations. But then, we find too many aberrations tumbling out, and as a result, aberrations are now becoming a norm rather than an exception. It is therefore our desire to focus on educating all the stakeholders about good practices and good governance. We sincerely feel that if all of us work together to arrest what I may call integrity deficit, fiscal deficit will automatically be contained. Our Prime Minister summed this up succinctly in a very recent meeting, stating that our approach, the government's approach, is to reform with intent, perform with integrity, and transform with intensity. In deciding the chief guest of the day, there was absolutely no discussion within the trustees. We were all very clear it had to be only the finance minister to be present and release the publication and also deliver the lecture on the most important subject today, roadmap to $5 trillion economy. When I spoke to the honorable minister a few months back about this program, she not only readily agreed but also allowed us to publish her speech, which she delivered in September 2011 at the Rani Sitai Hall on the subject, revisiting center-state relations. This speech very much forms part of the publication, and some of the observations which she made in 2011 are valid even today. Ladies and gentlemen, you will all agree that at such a critical juncture of the year, with the budget round the corner, if the finance minister has chosen to take time out of headquarters and be part of the celebrations in Chennai today, it only demonstrates her respect, regard, and admiration for one individual. His name is Nani Palkhivala. A word about our chief guest. I do not want to fall into the common cliched trap by stating she needs no introduction. Of course she does not. But for the sake of good order, it is appropriate that I spell out some of her background and achievements. Born and brought up in Tamil Nadu, she obtained a Bachelor of Arts degree in Economics from Sitalakshmi Ramaswamy College, Trichy. Thereafter, she did her Masters in Economics and MPhil from JNU, Delhi. She also enrolled for a PhD in Economics with a focus on Indo-European trade. She joined the BJP in 2006 and was the party spokesperson between 2010 and 2014. In Modi 1.0 in 2014, she became the Minister of State of Commerce Independent Charge and Minister of State Finance under Shri Arun Jaitley. In 2017, she was appointed Minister for Defence, becoming the second woman after late Indira Gandhi to hold the post. In Modi 2.0 in 2019, she was appointed Finance and Corporate Affairs Minister. She presented her maiden budget on 5th July 2019 and will present her second budget on 1st February 2020. It is appropriate now to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, with the famous quotation of Nani Palkhivala, which rings in our ears on a daily basis. And this is 3 decades old. He mentioned at that time, the most persistent tendency in India has been to have too much of government, too little administration. Too many laws, too little justice. Too many public servants, too little public service. Too many controls and too little welfare. We must admit, ladies and gentlemen, with a fair degree of conviction that in the last 5 to 6 years, there has been a marked and conspicuous reversal in the phenomena mentioned above. If all of us work together and channelize all our energies in executing all the ideas on the ground, $5 trillion number is imminently achievable. On behalf of the foundation, I once again welcome all of you to this very special event, and also our chief guest for being part of this celebration. Thank you, one and all.
Please now welcome Mr. S. Mahalingam, Managing Trustee, Palkhivala Foundation, to share with us the activities report of the Palkhivala Foundation and Nani Palkhivala Arbitration Center.
So, Mr. Nirmala Sitharaman, Honorable Minister for Finance and Corporate Affairs, Government of India, my fellow trustees of Palkhivala Foundation on the dais, Anand, Ranganathan, Balaji, and trustees of the dais, Raja, Jayakumar, and Governing Council member, Mr. S. Ram, business leaders, invitees, and friends. I extend a warm welcome to all of you on this memorable occasion, that of the centenary celebration lecture by Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman. Amongst the many contributions of Mr. Palkhivala during his lifetime, a significant one was the shaping of minds of people on the economy and the budget. When we sent out invitations to people, most of them replied saying how they used to look forward to the post-budget speech by Mr. Nani Palkhivala. It is therefore fitting that the Union Minister of Finance is here to deliver a lecture on the occasion of the birth centenary of Mr. Palkhivala, and that too, as Anand mentioned, deliver this lecture so close to the Union Budget date. He quoted Mr. Palkhivala, and I can't refrain from quoting him. Mr. Palkhivala, who was of course known for his oratory, once said in a public speech, "To tax and to please is not given to men and women, but to tax and to be fair is." Mr. Nani Palkhivala was born on 16th January 1920 and passed away on 7th December 2002. Palkhivala Memorial Trust in Mumbai organized a centenary lecture this year on his birth anniversary on 16th January, and the birth centenary lecture was given by the chairman of Tata Sons, Chandrasekhar. The Tata Sons Group, Mr. Palkhivala served as a director from 1961 to 1999. Our trustee, Mr. Arvind Dattar, who is unfortunately not able to come here today because he's not well, was a key figure in that function at Mumbai. They released a book edited by Mr. Arvind Dattar, which has essays written on in his honor, reminiscences of persons who interacted with Mr. Palkhivala, and a few articles which are written by Mr. Palkhivala himself. I have the honor of knowing Mr. Palkhivala. He was the chairman of Tata Consultancy Services from 1968 to 1996, except for a gap of 2 years when he went as India's ambassador to the United States. Other than interacting with him on work as my chairman, I was also his coordinator for his lectures in Chennai from 1983 until the last lecture he delivered here in 1994, after which he ceased giving post-budget public lectures. I could experience firsthand the range of his interests when he came to Chennai. I accompanied him once to Chankara Netralaya, where I came to know of the significant amount of donation he had made to that institution without his name being projected. It was also an occasion when he made a memorable speech, an extempo one, to the staff of Chankara Netralaya. He used to go to Kanchipuram for meetings with Paramacharya, the sage of Kanchi, on whose urging he took over as the chairman of the Veda Patanidhi Trust. I've also accompanied him to Theosophical Society, where he gave an erudite lecture on civilization, man, past, present, and future. He was a man of many parts. As I interacted with him, I could see how genuinely happy he was in coming to Madras and interacting with people from all walks of life. If ever a colossus strode across the Indian legal arena, it was Nani Palkhivala. Early in his career, he authored one of the finest commentaries on the law and practice of income tax. Kangan Palkhivala's law and practice of income tax is now edited by our trustee, Mr. Arvind Dattar, and the latest edition should be out soon. Palkhivala's reputation as a constitutional lawyer was formidable. Between 1965 and 1995, he argued nearly all important constitutional law cases before the Supreme Court of India. These included Golaknath, bank nationalization, privy purse, Keshavananda Bharati, St. Xavier's, Mandal Commission, and Election Commission matters. He also represented India in three major international disputes. I urge you to read a book, Nani Palkhivala, Courtroom Genius, by Soli Sarabji and Arvind Dattar, to get to know Palkhivala's journey as a lawyer and how the important cases that he argued changed the destiny of the country. He was fond of Chennai, and Chennai people reciprocated and came in large numbers whenever he gave public address here. He had many admirers here. So soon after he passed away, a number of his admirers in Chennai formed Palkhivala Foundation in February 2003. The founding governing council members were Mr. K. Parasaran, S. Ram, N. Murali, Dr. Badrinath, and N. I. Rangachari. Anand, Vijay Raghavan, Ranganathan, Arvind Dathar, and myself were the founding trustees, joined later by N. L. Raja, V. S. Rajkumar, Jai Kumar, and K. Balaji. Palkiwala Foundation was set up to continue his work. He shaped the thinking of a generation through his books and public speeches. At the foundation, we have so far organized 34 public lectures. Many of the leading lawyers of India, who also had worked with him, have been speakers in our public lectures. It is not just lawyers that we have hosted, but prominent persons from different disciplines have spoken. Mr. Narendra Modi delivered a foundation lecture in 2013 when he was the Prime Minister candidate. In addition to public speeches, we have also dedicated a constitutional law library in his name in the University of Madras. We organized leadership camps following the footsteps of Forum of Free Enterprise, which he headed. We wanted to also create an institution in his memory. Palkiwala Foundation promoted Nani Palkiwala Arbitration Center, called NPAC, to provide advocacy and leadership in speeding up the process of dispute resolution and doing it in a cost-effective manner. Our intent in starting NPAC was to create the ecosystem for speedy and cost-effective dispute resolution. Our interest is to promote institutional arbitration. Our members, most notably N.L. Raja, Anirudh Krishnan, and Arvind Dathar, contributed extensively to the report of the Law Commission headed by Justice A.P. Shah on the Amendments to Arbitration Conciliation Act, which was later made into law. Our members contributed to the Justice Sri Krishna Committee, which went into ushering in institutional arbitration. It's not only thought leadership that we provide, we train arbitrators at NPAC. We have organized arbitration centers in Chennai and Delhi. We organize an international conference on arbitration. This is truly an international conference bringing together legal luminaries from India and overseas. The conference discusses the march of law in key areas relating to arbitration. This year's conference is scheduled for 15th of February at New Delhi. While we have worked a lot in creating the necessary ecosystem for a truly efficient alternate dispute resolution system, the pace of progress in India in the use of institutional arbitration is still slow. Most of the arbitrations in India are ad hoc arbitrations. Dispute resolution clause does not engage the attention of legal people as they frame contracts, and a cut and paste approach is followed. When the dispute arises, they resort to ad hoc arbitration, which consumes time and costs a lot of money. We are working hard to change that approach. Our chief guest for the day, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, who has taken a lot of interest in this area and has also visited our center, has been one of our greatest supporters and urges us to set up a center of excellence. I urge business leaders and professionals assembled here to pay attention to this area. A quote from Mr. Palkiwala in one of his public speeches in 1987 goes like this: "A court of law is a Rolls Royce of 1907 vintage, stately and solemn, while an international commercial arbitration is a 1987 Honda car, which will take you to the same destination with far greater speed, higher efficiency, and dramatically less consumption." It would be a fitting tribute to the memory of Mr. Palkiwala if the Nani Palkiwala Arbitration Center that we have created in Chennai and Delhi in his memory acts as a catalyst to create the necessary ecosystem in India, enabling companies to arbitrate here instead of going to Singapore, London, and New York. Thank you.
I now invite Mr. K. Balaji, Trustee Palkiwala Foundation, to give us an overview of the book, Palkiwala Memorial Lectures, 2003 to 2019, Selected Speeches.
Honorable Minister of Finance and Corporate Affairs, Government of India, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, trustees of the Palkiwala Foundation, Governing Council members, ladies and gentlemen. My collaborator on this project, Sandhya Rao, journalist and author, will agree that the task of producing this compilation of 20 selected speeches was an interesting challenge. The selection itself depended on the availability of material in the archives of the foundation. Printed versions were available for 10 of the 20 lectures selected, which was very helpful. The others had to be transcribed from video recordings. Several factors have influenced the way the speeches have been edited and condensed. The more important ones being the year, which provided the context, the speaker's delivery styles, which went from the formal to the very conversational, and of course the topics themselves, covering a wide range of issues. In order to give you a flavor of the content in the book, I would like to read a few lines each from 6 speeches. I begin with the first memorial lecture delivered by Mr. Soli Sorabji, former Attorney General of India, on the Constitution of India, 22nd of March 2003. I quote, "To my mind, Keshavananda Bharati was Palkhivala's greatest contribution to our constitutional jurisprudence. The judgment has been a salutary check on Parliament's tendency to ride roughshod over fundamental rights and its insatiable appetite to encroach upon fundamental rights," unquote. Mr. Y.H. Malegam, a former president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, spoke on corporate governance, January 10, 2004. I quote, "In the final analysis, corporate governance is not a mere matter of structures and procedures. It has to be a way of life. In a sense, the issues it addresses in the corporate world are not different from the issues that society addresses in a functioning democracy. Thus, those to whom the assets of the corporation are entrusted for management are accountable for those assets and for the manner in which they manage them, and an assurance that no part of the assets have been diverted for personal gain, that there is adequate transparency in the manner in which these managers communicate this accounting to the shareholders, and that this accounting is subjected to adequate scrutiny, and the shareholder is entitled to rely upon the truthfulness of this accounting, and finally, that the rights of every individual shareholder are protected, and there is no oppression of the minority by the majority," unquote. Mr. Harish Salve, senior advocate, addressed the issue, "Judicial activism, are courts overstepping their limits?" 10th of September 2007. I quote, "What do we want? What have we developed over the last 3 decades? A vibrant constitutional organization that enforces transparency? I don't think that's a question that even calls for an answer. Is it free from troubles? No. But I will only quote one of the finest lawyers the country has seen, Lal Babu, L.N. Sinha. It was the Minerva Mills case. Mr. Palkhivala lambasted the government and his rhetoric was amazing. It mesmerized the court. And he spoke about how Mr. Gokhale insulted the judges. Lal Babu got up to reply, and I have never forgotten his opening words. In his soft, gentle voice, he said, I have only 2 things to say. First of all, let us remember that it is true that this court is the guardian of fundamental rights. And without this court, fundamental rights will not remain. But let us also remember that without Parliament, this court will not remain. The second thing he said was that a foolish judgment is not a ground to wind up the Supreme Court, just as a wrong law is not a ground to wind up Parliament," unquote. Lord Goldsmith, the former Attorney General for England and Wales, spoke on the art of advocacy, 24th of August 2012. I quote, "Despite the fact that you are here to win a case, that is no excuse to break the standards of ethical conduct which you as members of the bar here and I as a member of the bar in the United Kingdom need to obey. Advocacy is not a reason to misrepresent the position. It is not a reason to disrespect your opponent. Proper professional conduct is not just a sort of private thing between lawyers. It's not as if you're a member of some secret society, therefore we all act in the same way. It is critical that the courts, especially courts that are busy, utterly rely upon your integrity. Absolutely fight the case very hard, but never misrepresent what the position is, the law or the facts," unquote. Mr. Narendra Modi spoke on India and the world 18th of October 2013. He was then the Chief Minister of Gujarat. I quote, "In the present era, global warming is a big challenge. Countries with good solar radiation can form a club like G8, G20 and OPEC and give the solar energy movement a faster pace. Once when our PM was leaving for a G8 summit, I wrote a letter to him that why not we plan a summit? Why not a club of our own? I said where there was maximum solar radiation, Those countries should form a club and India must lead it. I even gave a name to the club, Sun Sun Movement. I requested that we create a corpus fund and conduct research on the solar sector and harness solar energy so that we can stop dependence on petroleum energy and avoid spending money on imports. But you know what might have happened to my suggestion, unquote. Finally, Dr. Indira Rajaraman, economist and a former member of the Central Board of Directors of the Reserve Bank of India, dealt with the topic, Decoding the Reserve Bank of India and Government of India Relationship, 3rd March 2019. I quote, I have a lot of faith in the RBI as an institution. It has a long history and it has guided us well. It has guarded the financial stability of the country, and I hope even though the RBI Act gives the government the upper hand, the government will continue to be proud of the way the RBI has functioned, be free to criticize it, and also take criticism from it, and not treat it like a department of the government of India, unquote. We hope you will, after reading the book, consider it was time well spent. Thank you.
At this moment, I invite trustees, Mr. N.L. Raja, Mr. V.S. Vijay Kumar, and the Governance Council member, Sri S. Ram, to the stage to be honored by Sri S. Mahalingam with a bouquet. May I request the Minister for Finance and Corporate Affairs, Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman, to release the book. Distributed to all.